Hello everyone, I am Santosh KG, Assistant Professor, Department of Mechanical Engineering, MIT, Mysore. In today's session, we will learn one of the experiments in design laboratory, which is journal bearings. So before going to the experiment, first let us learn some of the theory concepts which is related to journal bearing. Since a journal bearing is a type of bearing, first we should know what is a definition of a bearing. So bearing, it is a machine element which can be used in order to support, guide and restrain the moving elements. Since the bearing supports the moving elements based on the type of the motion that is exhibited by the moving elements, we are going to classify the bearings into two types. One is called as a sliding contact bearing and the second one is called as a rolling contact bearing. One of the example for a sliding contact bearing is a journal bearing and one of the example for a rolling contact bearing is a ball bearing. So the journal bearing will come under a sliding contact bearing. So now let us see what is a definition of a journal bearing. If the bearing is used to support this moving member like rotating shaft, then the bearing is called as a journal bearing. Here this diagram represents the schematic representation of a journal bearing. Usually the journal bearing, it is in the form of a sleeve that will be on the shaft. So the shaft will be inserted on this sleeve which is called as a bearing. The bearing is fixed and this shaft is going to rotate at certain speed. So the portion of this shaft which is inside the bearing, it is called as a journal. So journal is nothing but it is the another name given to the shaft which is inside the bearing. Now in case of the bearings, so when shaft it is rotating inside a bearing, due to the contact between the shaft as well as bearing, there will be a friction. So in order to eliminate the friction between these moving elements, we will be supplying the lubrication in between the parts. So the based on the type of lubrication we are going to supply in between the shaft as well as bearing, we are going to classify the lubrication into mainly two types. One is called as an hydrostatic lubrication and another one is called as an hydrodynamic lubrication. So hydrostatic lubrication is the one where the contact between the shaft and the bearing is separated by the external pressure, which is supplied by mainly using the pump. In general bearing, the mode of lubrication we are going to provide is hydrodynamic lubrication. So since the pressure is generated due to the rotation of the shaft itself, in this experiment our interest is to see what is the amount of pressure that will be developed inside the bearing. After measuring the pressure, we are going to draw the pressure distribution curve and to determine the load carrying capacity as well as the coefficient of friction and power loss in viscous friction. Now we will start the experiment. This is the experimental setup of the journal bearing which we are in our college. This is the shaft and this shaft is rotating inside the bearing which is placed in the casing. The specification of this bearing is given here. The diameter of the shaft which we have used, it is having a diameter of 24 millimeters and inside diameter of this bearing, it is having the diameter of 25 millimeters. So in order to measure the pressure, we are making use of these manometer tubes. So inside the manometer tubes, we have placed the oil. We have filled the oil. The oil which is placed in the manometer tubes, it is SAE40. At the room temperature, the oil is having a viscosity of 0.3 Pascal second. And then the length of this bearing is 100 millimeters. Then the eccentricity ratio is 0.63. The oil is supplied to this manometer tube by making use of the oil tank which is placed over here, which is behind the setup.
So using this oil tank and this pipe, we are supplying the oil in between the shaft as well as the bearing, in between the clearance that is present between the shaft and the bearing. Now we can see that the shaft is at rest, it is not rotating. So when the shaft is not rotating, if you see what is the length of the oil in the tube, you can see all in all the tubes the length of the oil is same and it will be equals to 94 centimeters. Now if you see how many tubes we are using in order to measure the pressure is, this is the tube 1, tube 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So in order to measure the pressure on the circumference of the bearing, we are making use of 12 tubes which are placed at equiangular distance. So the total angle is 360. So 360 divided by 12, it will be 30 degrees. That is, the one pipe, the angular distance between the one pipe and the second pipe, it will be 30 degrees. So you can see here, this is the tube 1 whose the pressure which can be measured by making use of this tube. And this is the tube 2 and it is going to measure the pressure at an angle of 60 degrees and it can be measured by taking the length of the oil present in the second tube. Similarly, if you want to measure the angle at an angle of 90 degrees, we can see the length of the oil which is present in the tube 3 when the shaft will be rotated. So before the shaft is rotating, the length of the oil is same in all the tubes. It means that the pressure will be uniform throughout the circumference of the bearing. We are going to rotate the shaft at a standard speed of 60 rpm. So in order to rotate the shaft, we can make use of this dimmer. So when you rotate the dimmer, we can see that the shaft is start to rotate. So when the shaft rotates, you can observe the length of the oil in these tubes. So the length of the oil in these tubes, they are changing. It means that the pressure at different points on the circumference of the bearing, they are going to change when the shaft is rotating, starts to rotate, and they are not constant, it is varying continuously. Now by making use of this tachometer, I am going to set the speed of this bearing to 60 rpm. So if I by rotating the dimmer and by making use of this tachometer, I am going to measure the speed and I am going to set it to 60 rpm. So when the speed is set to 60 rpm, we can see the length of the oil inside the tube, it is continuously varying. Now we will allow the oil to settle to certain height by allowing the shaft to rotate to certain interval of time. Once the length of the oil in the tubes come to the rest condition, we will measure what will be the pressure or what is the pressure at each point by measuring the length of the oil in each tubes. In the experimental setup, we saw that in order to measure the pressure in case of the general bearing, we are making use of 12 tubes which are placed at equiangular distance. So the total angle will be 360. If I divide it by 12, then we will get 30 degrees. So with respect to the vertical reference, the first tube will be placed at an angle of 30 degrees, and with respect to the vertical reference, the second tube, it is placed at an angle of 60 degrees. Similarly, the tube 3, it is placed at an angle of 90 degrees. Then the fourth tube, fifth tube will be placed like that up to 360 degrees. So the first tube, it is at an angular distance, at an angular distance of 30 degrees with respect to the vertical axis. The second tube, it is at 60. Similarly, the third tube is at 360 degrees or 0 degrees. So we already saw that when the journal is not running, the all the tubes we are getting the same radius, that is 94 centimeters. When the journal starts rotating inside the bearing, we saw that
the pressure inside the bearing, the pressure at different points they were varying. As a result, the height of the oil inside the tube, it was varying for certain amount of time, and after that it got settled at certain height. So we measured that at tube 1, after running the shaft at 60 rpm for some time, it got settled at 104 cm. Similarly, the head of the oil in the tube 2, it was found to be 67 cm. Similarly, the head of the oil in tube 3, it found to be 68. Similarly, the readings of the head in different tubes measured, we have written it in this column. So HI represents the initial head of the oil before running the journal, and HF represents the height of the oil after running the journal for certain interval of time. Now if we take the difference, we get in first tube that we get the difference of 10, and in second tube we get a difference of -23, -22, like that it is going to continue. Now let us see, by making use of this initial head and final head, how we can draw the pressure distribution curve.
The pressure distribution curve can be drawn like this. First, we need to draw one horizontal axis followed by the vertical axis. Then we will draw one circle which is having a radius of HI centimeter. So the initial head is 94 centimeters. So 94 centimeters cannot be written right in a page. It cannot be written in a page. So what we are going to do is we are going to take a scale. So in a scale we have taken, let us say, 1 centimeter represents 10 units of head. That is, in this, if I write 1 centimeter line, it represents 10 units of HI. So here the initial head is 94. So if I divide 94 divided by 10, I will get 9.4 centimeters. So first I am going to draw a circle which is having a radius of 94 centimeters. After drawing a circle of 94 centimeters, now I need to represent the tubes. So the tubes are placed at an angular distance of the first tube. It is placed at an angular distance of 30 degrees. The second tube, it is placed at an angular distance of 60 degrees with respect to the vertical line. Next tube, it is placed at an angular distance of 90 degrees with respect to this vertical line. Similarly, the fourth tube, fifth tube, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. They are placed at 30 degrees interval. After writing the tubes, now I am going to represent what is the final pressure at each tube. So in the first tube, the final pressure is 104, but we have already drawn a circle which is having a radius of 94. So if I subtract 104, if I subtract 94 from 104, I will get plus 10. So what I am going to do is, so from here to here, the distance is already 94. For this, if I add additional 10 centimeters, additional 10 units, which is nothing but 1 centimeter, then it will be 104 units of HF. Then in the second tube, we are adding HF of 67 units, but the initial head in the second tube, it was 94. Now it got reduced to 67. That means the pressure get reduced by 23 units. So 23 units, if I divide it by 10, I will get it as 2.3 centimeters. So from this circle, you need to measure 2.3 centimeters in downward direction, and you should mark a point in the second tube. Similarly, we are going to mark each the points, 2.2 centimeters, 0.9 centimeters, 0.3 centimeters along the respective tubes, and we are going to join them by making use of a curve. So when you join them by making use of the line, you will get the pressure distribution in case of a general bearing. So the lines which are drawn in yellow color, it represents what is the amount of pressure that will be acting in each tubes. After learning how to draw the pressure distribution curve, now the next step is to find what is the amount of power loss due to viscous friction. So to calculate the power loss due to viscous friction, we will be making use of these formulas, and in these formulas we are adding certain standard terms which are given in the observation or the specification. While seeing the experimental setup, we saw that the diameter of the shaft which we have used is adding 24 millimeters. In terms of meters, it will be 24 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meters. Similarly, the diameter, inside diameter of the bearing, it is 25 millimeters, or in terms of meter, it will be 25 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meters, and it is denoted by capital D. And we rotated the journal at the speed of 60 rpm, and we have denoted it by letter small m. Then we have used the oil, which is SIA40, and it is having a viscosity of 0.3 pascal second, and we are denoting it by the term eta. Then the length of the bearing which we have used in the experimental setup, it is having a length of 100 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meters, and it is denoted by L. And the attitude of eccentricity ratio, it is denoted by epsilon, and it will be equal to 0.63. So to calculate the power loss, first we need to find what is the speed, and then we need to find what is the frictional force. So if you calculate these two, we can calculate what is the amount of power loss that is happening due to the viscosity of the oil we have used. So first let us calculate the U. The U can be calculated. U is nothing but, it represents the linear speed of the journal, and it can be calculated by using the formula pi d n by 60, where d represents the diameter of the journal and n represents the speed at which the journal is rotating. So we know that the diameter of the journal we have used is 24 into 10 to the power of minus 3 meters, and it is rotating at a speed of 60 rpm. So if I substitute those things in this equation and if I simplify it, I will get the speed of a journal as 0.075 meters per second. Similarly, we can calculate the diametrical clearance by using the relation C by D, where C represents what is the radial clearance, the diametrical clearance that is present between the inner diameter of the bearing as well as the diameter of the shaft. So we know that the inner diameter of the bearing is having 25 millimeters, and the diameter of the journal is 24. If I divide it by the diameter of the journal, I will get the clearance ratio, diameter clearance ratio as 0.041. Then we can calculate the load carrying capacity by making use of this formula, where eta represents the viscosity of the oil, which is 0.3 pascal per second. U represents the speed of the journal in meters per second, which is 0.075, and L represents the length of the journal, which is 100 millimeters. Then epsilon, it represents the attitude ratio, it will be equal to 0.63, and xi represents the diameter clearance ratio, which should be 0.041. So if you substitute all these values in this equation, we'll get the value of W, and it will be equals to 166.5 newton, and that is the load that will be acting on the shaft when it is rotating. Then we will find the frictional force by making use of the equation 4 pi eta UL divided by xi. We have already found the value of zeta, and eta represents the viscosity of the oil, which we know already. Then U, we have already calculated. L represents the length of the journal. So we can calculate Fu as 6.576 newton. Then we can calculate the coefficient of friction by using the formula frictional force divided by load carrying capacity. So if we divide the frictional force by load carrying capacity, we will get it as 0.0394. Now we can calculate the power loss due to viscous friction by using the formula frictional force multiplied by the speed of the journal, and if you divide it by 1000, you will get the power loss in terms of kilowatts. So if you substitute F mu, which is frictional force, which is 6.576 into the speed of the journal, which is 0.075, if I divide it by 1000, I will get it as 4.95 into 10 to the power of minus 3 kilowatt. So this is the amount of power we need to supply to the journal to overcome the viscous friction. This completes the calculation part of the journal bearing.